Mama tumba jumde de deje sabanda jum ya thaba zube sanje banja wa sa ja tu wa ma cha se je ja su ji wo ju do jin ye la do Daya thayon munay munay maha munaye su Daya thayon munay munay maha munaye su Daya thayon munay munay maha munaye Daya thayon munay munay maha munaye su Daya thayon munay munay maha munaye su Daya thayon munay munay maha munaye su Daya tha om muni muni maha munaye su Daya tha om muni muni maha munaye su Yeah. Yeah, before listening to the teaching, necessary to cultivate the pure motivation. This is because this action, listening, teaching at this time, has to be differently than our usual life activities. If this present action, listening, teaching, even this action which we think is special action, a specific, you know, special action that we do in our life at this time, if it is same as, if it is not different, nothing higher than usual daily life activities, what we do in each day, eat, drink, sleep, all these life, daily life activities, if there's no difference between them, then this particular action, listening, teaching, does not become any special, higher, or holy. One thing, as I told briefly last night, I'm not sure what you all have heard, but however, religious action or spiritual action or spiritual work, whatever it is called, religious or spiritual or dharma, whatever it is called, it has to be a method. Which can destroy completely the whole suffering. It has to be a method which brings the cessation of the suffering. not just temporarily stopping the suffering, such as, you know, the simple, ordinary, you know, the sufferings that which human beings and even animals they can recognize, such as fever, such as a headache, such as pain, you know, stomach pain, all kinds of these sufferings. Not just temporarily, you know, stopping it. Because temporarily curing it, that even the medicine, even the external things can do it. Temporarily stopping it. That even the external things, without the need of religion, without the need of Dharma, even the external things can do it. So there's no need to really, there's no really purpose for the religion to exist. So, the spiritual action or the religious action, this should cease the continuity of the suffering. To cease completely the continuity of the suffering, that depends on completely eradicating the root of the whole, you know, the thousands, billions of the sufferings. That is the delusion, ignorance, and all other delusions that which arises from the root, the ignorance. So real, the true, you know, peace, the everlasting happiness, the real freedom, that is received. Whenever we receive the complete cessation of the root of the suffering, the delusions, the ignorance, so that is the cessation of the ignorance, anger, attachment, that is the real freedom, that is the real peace. That real freedom, that real, you know, peace, that true, you know, peace never changes. Once it is received, it's impossible to change. It's everlasting. Why it's impossible to change? Why it is impossible to come down, to disappear? Why? Why it's impossible to again, you know, fall down and suffer? Why? That is because there's no cause. There's no cause which makes the person to again involve in the boundaries of the suffering after receiving the everlasting happiness. That real perfect peace. There's no cause which makes, the person to get involved again in the suffering. Why? One day we're happy, you know, one day, For instance, one day, when you hear good news, or when you are in the in a beautiful, in a desirable, in a place, or when you receive some material gifts, or when you see some friends, you know, you feel very happy. You feel very happy. Sometimes, you know, feeling very, very happy, you don't know what to do, you know. Sometimes, sometimes by feeling very happy, you die. You know, you cause, you know, feeling very, very happy, you cannot control. Then you do crazy things. Then it causes danger, you know, danger to the life. Sometimes, there are many examples. Many examples. Anyway, what I mean is this. For instance, one day, 2 days, you know, like this. But such happiness that we have received by, you know, by having met such condition, this does not last. It's not everlasting. But, you know, having met friends that you, you know, who are, you know, your desirable object, you know. At the beginning we feel, you know, happy. But this happiness it does not last. By eating, you know, delicious food, you know, or wearing good, you know, the, you know, rich clothes, or by having met these conditions, all these pleasures that we receive, does not last. Why this type of happiness does not last? Why? As we experience the happiness first, why it does not last all time? What makes it to change? Afterwards, you know, are getting tired with that. Instead of continuously experiencing, you know, pleasure, feeling, you know, happiness. Oh yeah. Oh. That is because mainly mind is not free from the root of the suffering. Mind is at, why? Mind is under the control of anger, attachment, ignorance, those, you know, many of those delusions. So because of the, you know, our mind being under the control of these delusions, root of the suffering, therefore, even, the pleasures, that we receive by, you know, having met the conditions, all those, you know, does not last. All the time it changes. Because this happiness that which we discriminate, these feelings which we discriminate as a pleasure by us, actually from Dharma point of view we call samsara pleasure, samsara pleasure. Pleasure that is, that is called this sudden feelings. That the temple, the temple heavy sufferings. As it decreases, so just that is called pleasure. For instance, if you are carrying, a very heavy load, backside, and after some time you get tired, get very tired, that is, another type of suffering. And so when we think, thinking that it is caused by this load, carrying backside, and then take leave that load, you put it down, then at that moment you may feel a kind of you feel light, and that time that heavy suffering which you had before, that experience little bit goes down, little bit diminishes. So just it's not completely ceased, but it just a little bit went down. So just that feeling, that heavy suffering, that just a little bit decreasing, that is called pleasure. That feeling, that type of feeling, we just discriminate as a pleasure, which is experienced by such this uncontrolled mind and uncontrolled the uncontrolled body. If that also that pleasure, first time you feel, you feel stronger, then afterwards, again it doesn't last. Same thing person who has been sitting long time with crossed legs, he gradually then he gets pains around legs and the backside, all like this. Then after some time, he thinks better to stand up, Then he stand up. When he stand up, of course because the condition, the uncomfortable feelings that he had before, it little bit goes down. It changes, it little bit goes down, so he thinks this is a pleasure. He discriminates, this is a pleasure. But thinking, standing is a pleasure. If he stands all day, all night, you know, he doesn't have to stand all day, all night, even just 1 hour, you know. 3 hours, if he stand, he will get tired by standing, you know. Again, that, you know, pleasure does not last, does not carry on. It changes. Before it went down. Then again, deceiving trouble, you know, it went a little bit, you know, become less. Then again, by standing, again another problem comes. Again another problem comes, you know, by standing. So again there's a, you know, a problem, suffering. Like this. So again the person thinks maybe better to sit down. Again sit down. So however, this is just example. So however, there's this is just one example, but there are many other examples in our life. We change. Always we try to change. Maybe this is better. We try this. And then afterwards, you know, we get bored and we, you know, not happy with it. Again, there's another problem. Then we change. Or maybe better with that, you know. Or something. Always like this, with clothes, you know, with the people like this. Always we change people, you know. Maybe better that person. And try to live with that person. Or then, then after some time, you know, not happy with it. Or maybe better with this, better to live with that person, you know. Better to marry with that person. Or better, you know, all like this. Always changing. Object of the senses, you know. Food, clothing, or object of the senses, the five senses, you know, we, all the time we try to change. However, this, this shows there's something wrong, in our mind. This shows, you know, It clearly shows that there is the, you know, base of the base, the root of the suffering. There is the base of the suffering. It shows something wrong with our mind. You know, something wrong with our body, something wrong with our mind. So what's that mistake? What is that cause? No matter how much we, what is that cause which makes us, you know, how much we enjoy the pleasure of the senses? Never, there's no end. No matter how much we enjoy the pleasure, you know, the pleasure of the senses, how much we experience? There's no end. There's no nothing. There's nothing to finish. There's nothing to complete. You know. Nothing to finish. How much we have been experiencing? There's no end. We experience and that finishes. And again we try another one. And that experience, that we receive that experience again. That doesn't last. Finishes. And with like this, again try and try. You know. Since we were born until now. So like, since we were born until now, like this, you know, from, like this, as I told it last night, the beginningless, you know, the mind has been, the continuity of the mind has been beginningless. So, the continuity of our life has been beginningless. So, like this, from the beginningless lifetime until now, we have been experiencing all the pleasures. We've been experiencing all the samsara pleasures,
which are temporal, which are not true pleasures. As I have given those examples, we have been experiencing all the pleasures from the beginningless samsara lifetime until now, but nothing has been ended. Those pleasures have been always changing and finishing. Still, there is no satisfaction.
And the work, what I mean is not ended, is the work, the effort that we put in it to gain the, you know, the pleasure, the senses, again, you know. By trying different methods. This has not been ended from the beginningless lifetime until now. This work, you know, is not finished. So, what causes this? What makes, you know, to not last these pleasures, and what makes us to, again, you know, seek another, you know, pleasure. Again, you know, putting effort. And experiencing misery, you know, the suffering, you know, by diminishing this the pleasures. What causes it? What makes it? What is that thing? That is the answer to this question. That is our basic suffering. Our basic problem. The main cause which makes us to continuously, you know, to experience the various, you know, the sufferings, to not last, you know, these pleasures. All this because our body, because our mind is under the control of delusion and karma. Karma is the action of the delusions, actions which are produced by the delusion. That is called karma. Mind that which is under the control of delusion and karma, because mind is under the control of delusion and karma, so the body is also, the body is also, at the same time, the body is also under the control of delusion and karma. As long as the mind is not free, the body is not free. Body is not free. So the mind, so therefore, now we can understand. the real freedom, the real freedom. Oh, that is the mind, you know, completely free from the delusion and the karma. By mind being free from the delusion, from the boundaries of the delusion and karma, the body which is the house of the mind. That is also become free from the boundaries of the delusion and karma. So when the body and mind both are free from the suffering, the delusion, the boundaries of the delusion and the karma, that time, both mind and body, what if the mind takes different time? What if the mind takes different body, manifests different body? What if the body and doesn't have such as suffering of death, such as suffering of rebirth, such as suffering of old age, or such as suffering of sicknesses, or pains, For instance, at the moment, when we meet object of the senses, when we meet the undesirable object of the senses, we suffer, For instance, such as when there's snow, when there's much rain, without clothes, heaters, things like this, we feel cold. Without air conditioning, things like this, and when the weather is hot, again we feel hot. I mean, we suffer. So like this, again, like this, object of the sense of the our tongue, when we meet, sudden food, we're not happy with it, we suffer. Same thing. With object of the sense of the ear, there's a sudden news, sudden sounds, we hear, we get sick, or we get, we suffer, not happy, all like this, with body, also like this, with eyes, also like this, with object of the eyes, so by sitting for a few minutes, with a cross leg, we feel pain, So all the time, continuously there's some problem. All the time, as we meet the different objects of the senses, all the time there are different problems that we experience. And even the body, even this body, there's no one small place. Small place, tiny place, like the size of the pores, tiny place, that we don't feel pain. Even a place of needle, even a tiny place of, the pointed needle, even that much place, we don't have, which does not feel pain, which does not feel, which is not in the nature of suffering, Even we don't have that much place, which does not feel pain. So Therefore, when thorn, you know, thorns, needles, you know, when something touches to the body, even so pointed, so tiny, we feel, you know, such a, you know, great pain. Even the, you know, the condition that external thing is so tiny, pointed, you know, nothing, you know. But the feeling what we get, the pain what we get is incredible. This clearly proves that the mind is in the, not free, living in the suffering. So because of that, body is also living in the suffering. How the body is living in the suffering? Because this how the mind and body is living in the suffering? That is because being it is bound. The body and mind, our body and mind is bound by the delusion and karma. It's controlled by the delusion and karma. If when we receive this complete freedom, the nirvana, which another title, nirvana, the complete freedom, the cessation of the boundaries of the delusion and the karma, when we receive this, nothing of the object of the senses, you know, can cause problem. Nothing the object of the senses cause, you know, unhappiness. Even, you know, even, you know, thousands of atomic bombs, you know, are thrown, it cannot destroy, it cannot, you know, condition unhappiness, suffering to that living being, whose mind is in that level. You know, free from all the delusion and the karma. So it is in the teachings it's called like this. all the living beings, who are living in the suffering, which means who are under the control of delusion and karma, all their suffering is it's included in three. That is pervading suffering, you know, pervading suffering. The another hand, it means the embracing the suffering, unchangeable suffering. All these temporal pleasures, which are not real true happiness, that all these are called changeable suffering. And the suffering of suffering, those are heavy, gross the sufferings, which ordinary, which even animals, they recognize. So the pervading suffering, that is the pervading. Why it's called pervading, embracing? Because the feelings, cognitions, consciousness, besides this enter the control of delusion and karma, there's no one single part that which is free from delusion and karma. There's not even a small part of the body. The whole body is under the control of delusion and karma, so that is called pervading suffering. Because the whole body is under the control of delusion and karma, that's why we find, problems, of everywhere. As long as the mind and body is living in the pervading suffering, being controlled by delusion and karma, there's always, those other suffering arises. Those are the different types of, suffering arises from that. Continuously. One after another. So totally, all like this. The whole suffering are the result of the actions. The impure action, the negative action. The impure action, the negative actions, are created by the impure mind, the negative mind. That is the delusions. All the happiness that rises from the action, which is positive, which is another way of saying positive, but positive, which means virtuous. The virtuous, the positive action is produced by the virtuous thought, the positive mind. So the evolution of happiness, how the happiness comes, and the evolution of the suffering, how the suffering comes, is a completely different. It's a completely different evolution. So this, since we, desire happiness and do not desire suffering, since we are living in the suffering, understanding of this evolution is extremely important, and not just the only the intellectual understanding, that is not sufficient. But the person to really experience, to really to stop continuously experiencing the suffering in the future, in the present, and to continuously experience happiness. To experience this, to receive this, not enough just having the intellectual understanding. The person has to act. The person has to put effort. other people, you know, other meditators, other people, their mind being pure. You know, creating good action, which brings, you know, result happiness. That just other people doing and thinking that you may receive, thinking and believing and expecting that, you know, I don't have to do anything, you know, I can experience and happiness, you know, the good result, you know, which are created by other people's good actions, you know. Such this, you know, expectations, such this, you know, conceptions are wrong. We can never, without putting our own effort, without putting individual himself, without putting his own effort, without, you know, without changing his mind, without making his mind virtuous, positive, and creating the action, without doing, without putting himself, you know, in the action, nowhere that the person can experience happiness. Any happiness, temporal happiness, or everlasting happiness, or any kind of happiness, there's nowhere to experience. This is just like, you know, one person feeling, you know, much, you know, hungry. And then he expects if his friends, you know, if they eat food, then it's okay. You know, expecting that, you know, this is like this example. This is like example, you know, I feel hungry. And my, you know, I expect that, you know, my feeling of hungry will stop. My friends eating food, you know, my friends eating food. You know, that will fill up my stomach, you know, they eating food, you know, it will fill up my stomach, like kind of expecting like this, you know, which is impossible, you know. So however, the point is this, the main point that I want to emphasize that, so we, it is time. Just at this time, necessary, you know, to put in the, necessary to act, to put in the action right away. So if you put right away in the action, then our present action becomes, you know, right away. Even though it is a poison, even though our action is a poisonous, you know. Even though our present action is a cause of suffering, you know, which is created by the poisonous mind, the delusions. With wisdom, you know, if we change our motive, if we change our mind, if we make it virtuous, positive, then right away, our present action, you know, even listening to Dharma, teaching, you know, it becomes, Good karma, good karma. Another way of saying in the Sanskrit term, you know, good karma. Virtuous action, which only brings happiness. So happiness, temporal happiness is not enough. You know, just receiving temporal happiness is not enough. We must receive the everlasting happiness, the cessation of the suffering. That is not, only only oneself, you know, one person, one soul, receiving the everlasting happiness, that is not sufficient. There are higher goals than that. There's a highest goal than this. The individual liberation. Just the mere cessation of the suffering. The highest goal, that is the enlightenment, the most sublime happiness. That is the stage which is completely pure of all the wrong, all the delusions, all the defects, dualistic mind. That is the stage. Which is all the knowledge, all the realizations. Nothing is missing. Also, all the sentient beings, they are continuously suffering without having method and wisdom to know how to escape from suffering or what is the cause of suffering. And the cause of happiness, what's the real, the everlasting happiness. Not having the wisdom to understand these things and not having method, how to practice, how to follow. And the sentient beings, all these sentient beings have been extremely kind all the time to me, to oneself, all the time. In the past time, present time, also in the future time, they'll be continuously, kind. They are the field from where the sentient beings are, the field from where I receive all my pleasure. Past, present, future life you know, pleasures. All my, you know, perfections I receive from them. So I must receive enlightenment. Only myself receiving the everlasting, only myself trying to receive everlasting happiness and not caring, giving up the sentient beings, not concerned of other sentient beings, is selfish. So therefore, I must receive enlightenment, the most sublime happiness, in order to release all the sentient beings from their suffering and lead in the path to enlightenment. By myself. As this is my responsibility. So, whatever the motivation or thought that we had before, now at this time we strongly feel it. We strongly try to dedicate our action of listening, teaching, for the sake of other sentient beings, for their happiness. Why I think, deeply feel in the mind, I'm going to listen to the teaching. In order to receive the most sublime happiness, the enlightenment, for the sake of all the sentient beings. Feeling in the mind is feeling in the mind as if you are the servant to all the sentient beings. Feeling in the mind, feeling within your mind, that to release, to make the sentient beings release from the suffering and lead in the path and enlighten them, as that is the biggest aim, the principle, you know, the most important aim. For that reason, I'm going to listen to the teaching. the subject. That is the Mahayana teaching. The teachings of the graduate, which explains the graduate path to enlightenment, which the graduate path, which is the path that all past, present, future Buddhas have gone through and received enlightenment, and this is the path that all the lineages, the followers of Guru Shakyamuni Buddha, all those the previous, you know, fully realized Pandits, all these the great highly realized the Tibetan Pandits, the higher lamas, have received enlightenment by completing the realization of the whole gradual path. So this is teaching which has been handed down with the experience, with the full experience. Not just in passing the intellectual words. To receive enlightenment, for the sake of other sentient beings, to quickly receive enlightenment, this most sublime happiness, the most, you know, complete the pure stage. And the complete knowledge. To receive this enlightened stage for the sake of others as quickly, that depends on receiving the principal cause of the enlightenment, the bodhicitta. Bodhicitta is a thought. Bodhicitta is this is a realization. This is a realization. this is a intuitive thought. Wanting to receive enlightenment for the sake of all other sentient beings. This bodhicitta, this realization, this pure thought, is a thought which never, instead of concerning only oneself all the time, you know, this bodhicitta, this thought, always concerns other sentient beings, other sentient beings. How to make other sentient beings, you know, to release from suffering and lead them in the path of enlightenment. Always this thought, this bodhicitta, this pure thought, always things, you know, always is things, how to benefit to other sentient beings in the most, you know, wise way, you know, in an extensive way. It is a thought. This is a thought, a realization, which is concerned only other sentient beings. Giving up oneself. And taking others in the most care. This is completely opposite. The Bodhicitta, this pure thought is completely opposite to the, you know, to the self-chasing thought, which is only concerned of oneself, which always thinks how to take care of myself, which is only concerned of oneself.
The self-chasing thought, which doesn't care for other sentient beings, which causes the other sentient beings to suffer, is a thought that doesn't care for other sentient beings, that cares only for oneself, that thinks only I am important, the most important. Bodhicitta is opposite to the self-chasing thought. So what is the most important preparation to do in order to receive enlightenment quickly? Try to receive bodhicitta, this pure thought. Receiving this pure thought needs preparation. It depends on receiving other realizations. In order to receive bodhicitta, one must receive compassion, just having partial compassion, compassion to only your friends, not for other living beings, compassion for only desirable objects, living beings that look beautiful, and not compassion for those who look violent or ugly. Such partial compassion is not enough. Also, much of what we believe to be compassion is mostly not real compassion, it is attachment. So to receive bodhicitta, what compassion is necessary? It is impartial compassion, compassion for all the sentient beings without excluding even one. Equal compassion for all sentient beings, not just suffering human beings or suffering animals, which we can see with our eyes. We need to have compassion for all the sentient beings living in suffering. There are all kinds of different types of sentient beings, some that we can see at the present time with our current level of mind, and those we don't see, there are different types of sentient beings. For instance, this is not the only universe. There is a great number of other universes, other universes. Many other different worlds than the Earth that we see. In many of those universes, other sentient beings live. Even modern scientists talk about this existence of other universes, things they don't believe before. However, there are different sentient beings who have different lives, living on various planets and different places that we don't see because of our limited intelligence, limited power of mind. Even on Earth, there are sentient beings that we see and those that we don't. Even just in this place, there are types of sentient beings that we see when our mind is ready and has the power to see them, just as presently we see human beings and certain animals. Anyway, there are six types of samsara sentient beings.